Nowadays, you can pick up a book like this for next to nothing. Whole libraries, years and years of careful selection and loving books, and maybe even some reading, set out by the side of the road for sale, for next to nothing. Unfortunately, I bought this one before, and it cost me, but it was worth it. Books can be used for many things besides reading. For exercising the ankles and toes with short, controlled bursts of movement. Or a book can be used to create a man with a bookish face. Can be done. I never really had a knack for telling good jokes, you know? The kind that slap your face and send your head spinning. My friend Samir Sabura, he could tell a fucking joke. He once told me a joke about rice pudding, two porcupines, and a jockstrap. I laughed so hard, I broke a tooth. But this is a book on bird fancying, as they say in the north of England. Took me ages to understand it. Even though I'm fluent in English, I read all of Macaulay's speeches in order to really like hear the English language. But this shit was not English. This was north of English and about pigeons and dogs. It is not stuff for the faint-hearted. It's a deadly serious book. One suspects, in fact, that after about 50 pages or so, it is actually not a book about keeping birds as a hobby, but something far more important, like how to keep a lover, or swindle your friends, or find inner peace. But after one has negotiated, appreciated, and ingested the ins and outs of keeping pigeons and doves, there are, considering the times, and you know what times we live in, whole libraries for sale, art books leather bound in Baghdad in the 30s, obstetrics and radiology texts, copies of British medical journals. Something for you as well, my friend, huh? First and second editions of The Sun Also Rises, huh? Waiting for Godot for the price of a few cigarettes. Considering the times, there is actually only one real rule to keeping pigeons. And this rule, this like golden rule, is not in this book. Never name pigeon after a member of your family or a close friend. For two reasons. Pigeons have very short lives. So when a pigeon named after an uncle dies, this can be kind of disconcerting. Second, these are dangerous times for pigeons. They can be caught and eaten, and well, cannibalism can kind of put you off a hobby. Huh? I began collecting and trading pigeons and doves when I was 15. This is when birds clustered like flies in the palms along the avenues, and my land was the land of dates. You remember that country? Huh? Back then, everyone could read. And when my smallest dove developed a fever, I took her to the hospital where there was access, free access, to all healthcare facilities. Parents were fined for not sending their birds to school. The basic indicators to judge the overall well-being of flying animals were some of the best in the world. And shut up, Ali, shut up, sorry. One of these birds I named Laka Fasih Zair, after my grandmother. A real show-off she was. Huh. This bird was known as the Dresden trumpeter. I bought this bird off a trader from North America, Columbia Livia in Latin. Now, my grandmother was tall and hard as a big stick, and she liked everything American. The woman drank her coffee out of a Campbell's soup can. She worked in a maid, as a maid in a hotel, wearing a set of white trainers from a Sears Roebuck catalog. You know Sears Roebuck? That a cousin sent her from Wisconsin. I was already a teenager when I got my first pigeon, but when I had trouble sleeping, she would hold me in her arms and sing to me, and her voice, it was like an old soft motor, clinking and clanking, much sweeter than any fruit. Ululu, ululu. Ululu, ululu al-ha'i'a. She only had 3 teeth in the front of her mouth. But she said that song was not really in the tooth, but in the roof of the mouth, where God lives. She was also a bit of a blasphemer. Laka'a Fasih Zayr was her name. I would actually write her name down for you because it's complicated, but we have no tenses. I became a student when I was 17. I had 6 birds by then. I had 1 white-winged dove also imported from America. She, I named Greta after my little sister. My father, he loved movies. So my mother, she named my sister Greta after Garbo. We were secular, my family. But my pigeons, they were a mix of Jewish and Muslim and Christian. And they would pick each other's feathers out from time to time, maybe even a little blood. But mostly, you know, they got along well and they shit in the same pile. And you know, I won third prize with Greta, 1989 at the International Bird Convention in Baghdad. Books have other uses. Now, I'm about 1 inch taller. Now, I'm a crooked man, a slanted man. Or to cut it short, for most of the world, I am an Arab. And I've come here today to speak to you about pigeons. My favorite bird, which you might know, is called the Zenaida Makrura, or the mourning dove. Its name derives from its long, mournful cooing call, which sounds a little bit like this. The mourning dove is a strong, fast flyer that flushes up with the whirring of its wings. This first dove I bought, I named after my closest friend, Samir Sabura. We went to grade school together. While I drew birds, he made up words. He made up a word for the sound of a stone falling. The sound that a fish's tail makes when it flicks the water. Flick-tish. And the sound that an apple makes when it is bit. Harrush. Samir Sabura. Strong, fast flyer that flushed up with a whirring of his wings. My grandmother, Laka'a Fasih Zayr, she took care of my pigeons when I was conscripted. Samir and I, we were in Saddam's army in 91. Not the, like, elite Republican Guard, just the ordinary troops. What luck. What luck that we managed to stay together throughout the war. We hid in the bunkers most of those weeks, cursing Saddam when our captain was out, and cursing the Brits and the Yanks the rest of the time. And I missed my pigeons. I missed my birds. But birds were prohibited in the bunkers. Prohibited. Prohibited by the laws of nations. As were the fuel-air explosive bombs, the napalm, the cluster and anti-personnel weapons, and the BLU-82, prohibited, just like the BLU-82, I call it, BLU-82 bomb, which is like 15,000-pound device capable of incinerating everything, flying or grounded within hundreds of yards. And me, I missed my birds. The way they looked at me, a bird can look at you. Their eyes are like little pieces of peace sailing your way. After the war, I sold them, one by one, all 12 of my birds, for food, for aspirin, but not before I sold the watch my great uncle gave me, the spoon my aunt gave my mother with my name inscribed the day I was born, not before I sold my Shakespeare, in Arabic first, then in English, because I knew that my birds would not be shown at the next convention. I remember. Everything we say these days begins with I remember. That is because everything we say from the past, we sell for a future in a bucket of slops and potato skins. You know, a bunch of dull bananas and a bag of shitty apples from Beirut costs a teacher's salary for a month, so only the rich eat fruit. And all we can do is remember. I remember a few months after the bombing stopped, my grandmother falling on a piece of like broken pipe, her thigh cut to the bone, little pink pills of penicillin was all we needed. But these were prohibited by the blockade, as are chemotherapy drugs and painkillers. Not again, Al. 5,000 pigeons die a month because of this blockade. No, sorry. 5,000 children die a month because of this blockade. I will count to 5,000 right now so you see how many 5,000 is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. It takes a long time to count that far. Little pink pills, that was all we needed to save. لَكَعَ فَسِيحْ زَيِّرْ, my grandmother. She lay in my mother's arms, rotting from the waist down, as the birds disappeared from the avenues because the trees had died. How many dates? How many birds? You see, the sadness in numbers is that they do not stop and there is always one more to follow. Just like birds. Listen. Do you ne'er think who made them and who taught the dialect they speak, where melodies alone are the interpreters of thought? The birds of Killingsworth. You know this? Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. He was one of Samir's favorites, along with Al-Mutanabbi and Kanafani. And of course, the poets of love. And what of love? What is a treatise on the pigeon and the dove if it does not treat the philosophies of love? I do not know. I do not know what love is. It goes and it comes. It goes and it comes. And if love is in pieces, then Samir Sabura, my friend, he is a piece of love. Tall, he was very tall, and a handsome fellow with big dark eyes. But, and I must admit it, he walked like a pigeon. Now, a pigeon is not really meant to walk, like its state of grace is to fly. But if a pigeon must walk, then our pigeon walks the way Samir walked, like this. It's possible his great-grandfather was a flamingo. Samir, he was intelligent, He was hilarious. But he did have one fault, I will admit that. He could not read a thing. He was terribly dyslexic. So we would do the reading for him. Samir was always carrying a book around, and whoever he came upon, he would say, Ya akhi, read to me. He'd memorize whole passages that he would recite at the most inopportune of moments. For instance, when I was 16, I had food poisoning. All day, I sat on the toilet, rocking and moaning, and I must say it, stinking as well. But Samir would not leave my side, huh? He would not leave me to suffer alone. Up and down the hallway, outside the bathroom, he strode, reciting pieces of heart crane. While I sputtered and farted in agony, snatches of the bridge sailed in and out of my consciousness and kept me from despair. And if they take your sleep away, sometimes they give it back again. Soft sleeves of sound attend the darkling harbor, the pillowed bay. Good friend Samir, huh? He had a library that even his teachers envied. Running his big hands over the spines, he would look at us and say, I cannot read them, but I can touch them. His knowledge of his books was so intimate that he could close his eyes and find a title by its smell. Books can also, in extreme times, be used as sustenance. But such eating makes for a parched throat. Many mornings I wake and I am thirsty. I turn on the taps, but there is no running water. A once modern city of 3 million people with no running water for years now. The toilets are dry because we have no sanitation. Sewage pools in the streets, and when we wish to relieve ourselves, we squat beside the dogs. At night we turn on the lights to read the books that we have forgotten we have sold. We go to the cupboards to eat cold cans of soup, but there is no food processing, so the cupboards are bare. A couple of us, we wanted to write like a few polite words of complaint to the United Nations Sanctions Committee, but they have banned the import of pencils because it is believed that they could be used to make weapons of mass destruction. Just recently, it was discovered, though, that at the very tops of some of the most remote mosques, nests have been found made entirely of pencils. This is illegal stockpile. Sometimes, if the occasion is right, a book is also for reading. Some say the world will end in fire, some say ice. From what I've tasted of desire, I hold with those who favor fire. Robert Frost, huh? You teach him in your school. 88,500 tons of bombs. Write this down without pencils. The equivalent of 7.5 atomic bombs, the size that incinerated Hiroshima. 900 tons of radioactive waste spread over much of what was once the land of dates. Somewhere within this information is a lullaby. Ululu, bahambu, bahambu, min awwal da'iqa. And this, my friends, is documented. Fact. By the European Parliament, 1991, the defeated troops were surrendering. We, a nation of unpeople, were surrendering. Samir and myself, alongside 700 other men, we were dirty and tired and hungry, sucking these orange mints because the napalm, it made our gums bleed. That morning, I had relieved myself by the others as invisible jets broke the black glass sky across the horizon. Samir did the same. And then we walked. We walked towards the American unit to surrender, our arms raised beside 700 other men. Samir, he said to me, I want to put my hand in a bucket of cold water. Shut up, I said. Shut up. And Samir said, I want to smell the back of my father's neck. Shut up, I said, we are almost home. And Samir Sabura said, I want to tell an astonishingly good joke until you cry for relief. As we walk towards them, and this is documented, the commander of the US unit fired at one man an anti-tank missile, a missile meant to pierce armor at one man. The rest of us, arms still raised, stopped walking. I remember I could not recognize my friend Samir. A piece of his spine stuck upright in the sand, and his left arm blown so high it was still falling. And then they opened fire on the rest of us. A bullet hit me in the back as I ran. But I lived. Out of thousands, out of hundreds, thousands that day, only a handful of us survived. It's funny that I am still here. You know, the dead, they are dead. The living, we are the ghosts. We do not even say goodbye to one another anymore. We just write our names down with the pencils we do not have so that the future will know that we were here, so that the past will know we are coming. In a world that seems so very puzzling, is it any wonder that birds have such an appeal? Birds are perhaps the most eloquent expression of reality. Roger Torrey Peterson, American ornithologist, born 1908. War is hell. Pete Williams, Defense Department spokesman, upon confirming that U.S. Army earth movers buried alive in their trenches up to 8,000 Iraqi soldiers. Yes, war is hell. And birds are perhaps the most eloquent expression of reality. In Arabic, we say, "Kus ukht al-dinya," which is like the equivalent of fuck that shit. I sold my last bird a few days ago. Tomorrow I will sell the cage. The day after that I will have nothing left to sell. But I keep track of the buyers and who the buyers sell to, and I go to their houses to ask for the bones. Most of the time the family is kind or frightened and they give me the bones after the meal. I boil the bones and I keep them in a bucket. Listen, it's like a kind of music. These are the bones of those who have died from the avenue of palms, from the land of dates. I've come here to give them to you for safekeeping. Catch them if you can.